Hello and welcome to this introduction to the RapidMiner Server. In this tutorial, we'll go through the different sections of the web interface of the RapidMiner Server to give you a head start for configuring your own platform. During this video, we'll reference the module around connecting and executing processes on the server frequently. It is not absolutely necessary to familiarize yourself with that video prior to this one, but it will be advantageous. We'll refer to it as the Server Basics video. Now, the first question to answer when dealing with the server interface is how to find it. Well, there are two ways. As we see, we have the RapidMiner Studio open here. In the repository panel, you see the server repository, which we established during the Server Basics. One very convenient way to access the server's web interface is to just use the right mouse button and select Administrator, Web Interface. Now the default browser is opening and we're presented with the login dialog, and this represents the second option to get to the web interface. Just open any browser and type http://yourservername:/your port number/faces/login.xhtml. Usually the port is 8080, so try that in case you're not sure what yours is set to. Alternatively, you can also use the IP address instead of the domain name. We'll log in with the admin account, which is one of the two special user accounts, together with the anonymous user. The admin user always does exist in any deployment and cannot be deleted, and there can always be only one with all administrator privileges. The anonymous user is for you to set up, but once you create it, then it is provided with special rights automatically. For more details, check out the documentation under the entry here in the Documentation Links section, or go to http://docs.rapidminer.com/directly and search for special users. The first page view we're presented with is the Home of the Repository section. Here we see a summary of recent events or recent places that have been visited. From the Browse Repository section, you can navigate through the folder structure. If we navigate into the data folder of the admin user's home directory, we can see the customer data which we copied and pasted there in the Server Basics video. If we select it, we get a summary of where it initially was imported from and what it contains. When we do the same on the process which we used in that same video, let's use the search page and the term validation to find it, we see that processes are actually stored as XMLs, and as we expand it, we can easily find the number of validations which we set to 1,000. Here, you can also create a Crone trigger if you want to run a process repeatedly or at a certain time. We'll do one for 7 a.m. each day. A helpful public user interface to create the expression is, for example, http://www.cronemaker.com. As soon as we click Submit, we're taken to the Schedules view, which is in the Processes section. We can see now our freshly scheduled process in this view. Here, you can pause the execution of scheduled jobs if needed. The next entry in our menu is called Executions. On this page, we can see which processes are running and also the previous executions. There's a filter and a search option provided in case you're looking for the status of a specific process. In the lower table, we see the past processes which have been run. Those with a green tick mark have been completed successfully. Should there be a little red X, it means something has gone wrong. You can then investigate that further through the log provided at the end of each entry. Below the entry Executions, we can find queues. Let's look at a default RapidMiner server installation briefly to help you understand what this is all about. The big box represents a host or virtual machine on which the RapidMiner server is installed. The orange box is the main application, which has one execution option embedded for executions related to web services and web apps. The elements here represent a job container and a job agent, respectively. Together, they form the second execution option of RapidMiner server. Job agents can be seen as separate instances or applications on a machine, and they can hold one or more job containers. Each job agent is connected to a job queue within the RapidMiner server, and they can be installed on the same or alternatively a different host. Job containers, as the lowest hierarchical element, are really execution applications and can be somewhat compared to CPUs, but they're not restricted to using single CPUs. In the default installation, we have one job agent and one job container each. Now, here you can see an example of a larger deployment with a total of four execution options. One is the execution engine within the server application. The second is the job container deployed on the host machine. And the third and fourth are job agents with containers, which reside on external machines. Two of the job agents have one job container each, and the third has two, and each of the three job agents is connected to a separate queue within the main server application. You can also have multiple job agents connected to the same queue. And as mentioned, each agent can be connected to multiple dedicated containers. So you're really very flexible to scale this to become a very powerful computation platform. Okay, with this, let's go back. Through the link shown up here, you'll be taken to our docs page where you can find out how to install additional job agents. If you want additional job agents to connect to another queue than the default queue, then you can and need to add one here. If you need to change anything on the default queue setup, like alter who has access or add additional job agents to it, then you can do this here. The next entry in this section provides the option to define web services. This page allows you to expose a RapidMiner process as a web service. You can invoke it via a URL and pass parameters in if needed. We'll just create a simple one here. First thing is to give it a name. We'll call it cross-validation. If we click on the folder icon, we can browse our server's folders and select our 05 cross-validation on server process. Make sure to click Select Location. Choosing the right output format is very important as there are so many options. We recently added OData format, which is open industry standard used by vendors such as SAP, Microsoft, Click, and others to exchange data. We'll leave the default here, which is XML, and we'll also leave the MIME type unchanged. Just below, you can add parameters to your web services. To finish creating the service, we hit Submit, and now we can test it by clicking on the gear icon. After it's been completed, we get the performance vector returned, which is basically the content of the confusion matrix, as displayed in the results view of RapidMiner Studio. In the Server Basics tutorial, we suggested to add a store operator in order to save your output. But here's another way of retrieving the output information of processes. On the right, you get an iframe, which you can copy and paste into your application or web page to invoke the web service. Alternatively, you can use this direct link. If we click that, we get prompted for the user ID and the password. I'll use the admin credentials. The process is then executed, and as output, we get our performance vector again. Now, what else can we do in this section? We can define a trigger. There is one which was already prepared, so let's inspect it by clicking on the notepad icon. This one is set to monitor a file change on the server. So every time the file myfile.txt changes, the cross-validation process will be triggered. Alternatively, triggers can also listen to incoming mails. We'll not cover the remaining section shown here, which is the administrative part of the server, but in essence, here is where you define your security groups and users and administrator permissions to features and folders. Further, you can define here your database connections and share them, your mail client settings, and the system settings of your server, as well as licenses. Last but not least, on the lower left, there's a link to the App Designer, which will allow you to create your dashboards. Of course, there are too many options around App Designer to introduce them in this tutorial. So we conclude our introduction to the server interface here. During this module, you've been introduced to the repository browser, the process scheduler, you saw how to create a web service and how a trigger is set up and what it does. Thank you very much for watching.